everyone, welcome to Buckle Up Podcast. I'm Natalia Earle and I'm a certified business and life coach that loves talking to people. I'm fascinated by humans and how our brain works. What is it that makes a decision good or bad, and how does that decision ultimately shape our path and destiny? Everyone loves to talk about success, but what about the flip side? How about adversity? Failure is such a big and often necessary part of life, and it's simply unavoidable. So I invite you to join me on this inspiring, honest, unpolished interview show with breathtakingly real conversations that go deep on setbacks and hardships that are part of the puzzle that ultimately lead to growth, discovery of inner greatness, and what makes us resilient. Grab your helmet and buckle up, people. It's going to be a bumpy ride, but what a ride it will be. Today's guest is Victor Avila. He's a retired Supervisory Special Agent with the U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement with over 20 years of experience. He's an author of a book, Agent Under Fire, A Murder and a Manifesto. While on assignment in Mexico, Special Agent Avila suffered multiple gunshot wounds and survived a violent ambush by the Los Zetas drug cartel. Unfortunately, his partner, Special Agent Jaime Zapata, was killed. Mr. Avila has been recognized for excellence in law enforcement and has received multiple various awards and honors. He's an advocate for border security, immigration reform, and human trafficking awareness. We had a great discussion on the current state of our border.
Please tell us a little bit about yourself. How did you arrive at the place where you are today?
My name is Victor Avila. I'm a retired ICE Homeland Security Investigation Special Agent. I have almost 20 years of law enforcement experience and service at the state level, the county level, the federal level, and even international level. I worked for the state of Texas that first started my career back when I graduated from college. I graduated with a criminal justice degree and then kind of figured what am I going to do with that degree? And so law enforcement was one of those things, but there's a broad sense in law enforcement as to what to do. And the federal service is always something that we strive for at that level to get, you know, because of the benefits and the good jobs. But I initially started at the state level, the state of Texas, then I moved up to the U.S. courts. And then while I was doing that, that's when I realized I wanted to be a criminal investigator. I really wanted to be a special agent, which is just a fancy word for criminal investigator, just like an FBI special agent or DEA special agent. This was under the U.S. Customs Service right when the Department of Homeland Security was being created. And so I was one of those first ones to merge and be one of the first students of a new academy. Even though it's mostly a U.S. Customs Academy, they incorporated the immigration in it because with the creation of the Department of Homeland Security, it brought two groups together, the U.S. Customs Special Agents and the Immigration and Naturalization Special Agents, and combined them what you know today as ICE, Immigration and Customs Enforcement. And so these are the investigators, but there's several divisions within ICE, and I could explain that. But I really wanted to get down and really get into the community. And I wanted to be the agent that investigated these cases. And I did. And so after about 5 years in the U.S. court system, I applied and was picked up by the U.S. Customs Service. And that started my law enforcement career as an agent.
Oh, wonderful. So how did you, I mean, I recently came across your book, Agent Under Fire, which was absolutely amazing. And it was so educational that it's a must read for everyone. So tell us a little bit, how did you end up in Mexico and on this really terrible case that you and your partner end up doing in Mexico?
Yeah, so I was stationed at the El Paso field office, and I had done a big case there that kind of got me my name noticed. I did a big corruption case. A corrupt Border Patrol agent was very successful in taking down that smuggling organization. And then it gave me a little bit of a clout in my office to be able to select what I wanted to do. And back then, this was 2008, there was an opportunity to go across the border from El Paso into Ciudad Juarez and help our U.S. agents there. We had two U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement agents assigned to the U.S. consulate there. And I put in for it. I received it. And initially, it was just a temporary duty assignment for several months. And then that initially actually ended up being a permanent assignment when I went to Mexico City, which is a U.S. embassy in Mexico City that oversees all the ICE offices in Mexico. And I was selected on a permanent basis to go there. And so in 2008 and moved my family in 2009 to Mexico City. And we, you know, we sold our house and left. And it was an incredible move to, you know, for several reasons. I wanted my kids to have more of an international feel. Mm-hmm. I wanted them to, we really wanted to leave El Paso and get a broader sense of living somewhere else. And that, but plus for my career, I wanted to expand my abilities as a criminal investigator, and going international was a good way of doing that. But Mexico was, as you know, a very unique place. We, even though we go as a diplomatic post, as an accredited diplomat, it was really a lot of hands-on work with the government of Mexico, helping them in many, many aspects, training, taking down drug traffickers, human traffickers. And it was the most I've ever worked in my life, and really took me away from my family. I really didn't expect that much. I knew it was going to be work, but not as much as it was. I mean, certain days, I talk about this in the book, that yes, you know, I neglected my family a lot. I was home very, very few times. And so, you know, I give credit to my wife and kids, how resilient they are, and they put up with me. And so, you know, we fast forward, I've been serving in Mexico almost 2 years, and 2011 comes around, and I get sent on assignment on February 14th, on Valentine's Day of 2011. I get an assignment to take the temporary duty agent that was there. I had just arrived the week before, Special Agent Jaime Zapata, to accompany me to go pick up some equipment from our agents from the Monterey office, and go pick up that equipment and return it. It was an awkward assignment. It was a rushed assignment. We didn't have the ability to, even though I questioned the assignment, there was not a lot of the regular standard operating procedures that we would usually do in Mexico because of the security issues. Right. And we knew that that road that we were going to travel on was very, very highly, you know, controlled by the Zetas cartel at that time. But nevertheless, I was ordered to go there, and, you know, we followed orders and we went, and we picked up the equipment on the way back. On this is February 15th. On the way back, we were ambushed by two SUVs full of Zetas cartel members. And tragically, Special Agent Jaime Zapata lost his life in the line of duty. I survived being shot 3 times by the grace of God. I'm here telling you the story. And so that's part of my duty as a survivor, is to continue to tell the story, because I think it's important for people to know, first of all, a lot of aspects of our immigration, U.S. Right. U.S. law enforcement serving abroad. We have U.S. personnel serving all over the world, and they're there and to protect our homeland and to continue to protect our sovereignty. And so it was, as you can imagine, it was a tragedy that turned our world upside down, not just mine, but my family's and friends and coworkers. And so that took me to many places around the world. Eventually in 2015, I sought a retirement. It wasn't a good separation. My agency didn't do a good job of at least taking care of my family and I, and there was a lot of issues there. Possibly right. Politically, I don't know to this day, but nevertheless, we paid the price for it. We had a hard time dealing with everything that was happening after the shooting. And so the best thing to do was to separate. In May of 2015, I was granted a medical retirement.
Yes, it was definitely gut-wrenching reading your story to see how the agency has failed you and your family. I couldn't believe it. You know, I was kind of in shock. And after all the hardship that you went through, that they didn't have your back, you know?
They didn't. And that's a good way of putting it. There was no backup there, and that we stay right. in the law enforcement world. And I never asked for anything special or special treatment. I just wanted them to take care of me. Just do something good for me and put me in a place, but they they didn't want to do that. And eventually I struggled with the loyalty to the government that I had. And I was a loyal federal employee, but I realized that they didn't want me back. It took me a while to realize that. And once I did, I said, I better look for other options. And to separate was the best way to do that.
Yes, definitely. So in your book, you have educated me so much on corruption, human trafficking, money laundering, the drug runners and mass murderers that are coming through the borders, and why the wall is so important. And I feel like in so many ways, this wall was so politically weaponized that people are having a hard time to listen and understand what the wall is there for and what it's actually doing for our community and for our country. So can you tell me a little bit how much of that you saw when you were working on the border in Texas, that how much, and you describe a lot again of that in detail, but this is really happening. It is a real issue. It has nothing to do with race or racism or, you know, whatever the, again, people are trying to make it a political game here. So give us a little bit more detail about that.
Yeah. So the wall, you're absolutely right. It became a political issue, and it's kind of unfortunate because they wanted to show that the wall was something that's going to separate two nations and somehow we're not going to talk anymore, or it's going to strain relationships. And that's just totally untrue. I grew up and was born and raised in El Paso, Texas, and one of the first places where the wall went up in 2006. Mm-hmm. And back then they were like, oh, you know, it's going to end all relationship we have in Mexico. And it didn't. What it did do is stop the illegal activity that came in between the ports of entry, and a lot of illegal aliens that would back then in El Paso would just jump the river. And there's another canal there, and a lot of them would jump into houses. I mean, we're talking right there on the border. A lot of them were killed by the freeway, a lot of crime. The wall solved all of that. And people still go to Mexico and visit their family. That still continued. That never trade and never was never interrupted by the wall. And the wall is just an additional tool that our border agents want. I mean, I wish I had the wall in certain instances when I worked down in El Paso County and Hudspeth County. There was this huge area where smugglers love that area. It's, you know, they have these points of entry that they love to come through. And I would have loved to have a big barrier there, because they used to drive SUVs full of drugs through the river. And now you got to understand that the Rio Grande River, there's places where it's very, very low water. And they would drive the SUVs through the river into the US, dump the drugs, and then drive back. That's something that the wall would end instantly. Backpackers, 16, 17, 18 individuals carrying drugs would run across into the US, dump the drugs in the brush, then run back. And then somebody else in the US would come and pick up the drugs. The wall would end that. And so the wall will help end a lot of things, but not everything. It's not going to end illegal immigration. We know that, but it's an additional tool that helps funnel the illegal traffic through a certain area to give our Border Patrol agents that additional time to respond to that area. The wall gives them that additional time. It, you know, we still have the other technology, the sensors, the drones, the lighting, everything else that we have. And so the wall just slows them down. You've seen videos of people jumping in the wall. That's always going to happen. But now we have Border Patrol agents on the other side waiting for them. I call the wall an additional manpower. I know sometimes you have agents patrolling a 100-mile border area, five agents patrolling it on one shift, and it's just impossible. So the wall helps them slow down that traffic and allows them to respond. And it's a shame that I just came back from the border last week, and I saw the gaps in the wall. And I just saw a news article yesterday, and that now the DHS secretary is thinking about completing some of those gaps, because even it doesn't take a genius to figure out, when you go down there, they abruptly stopped the construction of this wall, which even in the construction world, it's not a good idea to just stop a project. You have to at least finish it to a certain end. And they didn't even do that. And I'll give
Yes, I'm a big advocate on bringing awareness on human and sex trafficking. And I try to talk about this a lot and bring the awareness. And people don't understand how much of that is happening through the border. So can you tell us a little bit? I've read some gut-wrenching experiences that you witnessed, and as a father and as a, you know, a human being, how much it affected you. And tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, that's my subject matter expertise is human trafficking. That's what I focused on most of my career. And I rescued, you know, countless women and children from these horrific, horrific conditions. But you're right. The open border policy that's happening, it's only encouraging and bringing more of the exploitation of these kids and these women. So that so your listeners can understand, there's two crimes here. One is the smuggling. And it's different than the trafficking. The smuggling is a one-time fee. The person pays the cartel or the coyote, you know, $4,000, and that gets them into the U.S. By the way, they'll pay the money whether they're going to turn themselves in or whether they're going to be smuggled in. The cartel doesn't care. They're going to get paid. Right. And then, but then that's it. That's the end of that. The human trafficking portion is the continuation of the exploitation of that person for sexual exploitation or forced labor. There's a lot of forced labor going on in our country as well. And so I focused a lot on, obviously, on the sexual exploitation part, where they, you know, they take these women and these children and they sell them. It's a modern day slavery. And they, I, you know, I investigated cases in Atlanta, New York, Miami, Houston, all over the US.